Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. Looks like we got a few people still kind of coming into the building, so we're going to reverse the order just a bit today, and before we do kind of the more formal call to worship, I'm going to give you guys an opportunity now just to go ahead and greet each other as people are still coming in. So you want to stand, wave, say hi, et cetera, do that. All right, guys. You know, one of the most powerful things that we do when we gather together is see each other and visit with one another. So it is good to hear that, and I'm hesitant to even try to shut that down prematurely to be able for us to continue to visit. So just kind of want you to consider, you know, even as the worship service goes on and continues today, you know, pay attention to who's here. And, you know, if you've got a few minutes after the service, you know, this is this, you know, unique time. We used to do it with donuts and coffee before service. At some point, that'll all come back. But until it does, still make it a point. You may not know it, but there is someone who needs a connection, and your presence here makes a huge difference in their lives. So in addition to that, we've got some things that are starting up, and one is this coming Saturday, and it'll be every Saturday for the continued kind of the month of May. We are able to help with some food distribution for our area, and we're partnering with the River Bend Ministerial Alliance for that, and Mike Varner and Natalie Runyon know more details than I do, but there is stuff floating around. There's an Eventbrite link. We need volunteers to help distribute food, and then if you need food or you know people that need food, you know, get in touch with us because we'll have ample food to provide and give out this month. And it's where the old River Bend Billiards building was off of Broadway will be where we're passing out the food for that. So, and then just a couple other quick announcements of things that we don't really spend a lot of time talking about, but we do want to let people know about. We have a middle school and a high school youth group that meets every Sunday night up here from 7 to 8:15, and it is growing, and the kids are fantastic. I get to help with middle school. Mike and Gwen and Jill help with the high school, and but if you're like, wow, I would really love to hang out and spend some time with some middle schoolers and high schoolers, they really are an awesome group. And there's an opportunity to plug in there. So if you're interested, see us, come talk to us. Also, if you're like, wow, I didn't even know that that was a thing, and I actually have some middle schoolers or high schoolers, everyone's invited to come and participate in that with us. And then we have a Tuesday morning men's Bible study, we have a Thursday night women's group, and we have additional community groups. And as, you know, things continue to lift, those things continue to be available. So where this gathering here on Sunday morning matters and is important, we believe gathering throughout the week is also crucial. One other thing that's going to start on June 6th is a class here on Sunday mornings, and Dan Nickel is the teacher of that class, so I'm going to ask him to come and share a little bit about that class at this time. So, yep.
Good morning. Everybody hear me all right? My name is Dan Nickel, and last summer, June or July, when this church opened its doors back up to live worship, my lovely wife Cindy and I started attending this church. And so over the last couple of months, Pastor Stephen and I had some lunch conversations about a personal ministry that I've had in teaching. And so for the last 25 years, I've taught several adult, college, high school, Sunday school classes, Bible studies, and while teaching the college class for 3 years, I found out you better have answers to the most difficult questions in life. And so I pursued a master's in culture apologetics at Houston Baptist University, and through that, other doors have opened, allowing me to teach at three different Metro East churches on faith and film Bible study series. And so with Pastor Stevens and the elders' support, our church has graciously allowed me to start a new Sunday school class, as Pastor Stephen said, June 6th. Starts at 9 o'clock. It'll be every Sunday. It'll go from 9 a.m. to 9:50 on a continuous basis. In Acts 17, in Paul's famous Mars Hill speech to the Athens philosophers, the intellectual elite, Paul used imaginative literature of two pagan poets, and perhaps even Homer's Odyssey Cyclops scene, to teach them about a transcendent supernatural God and his relationship with his creation. And so Paul clearly thought the combination of the arts and imagination and the rhetoric of reason would be an effective approach to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to the pagan culture he lived in. When engaging today's culture, that has no warring center anymore. We're influenced 24/7 by movies and TV and literature and music and poetry and theater. God and the good news of Jesus Christ needs to be brought into that conversation. The arts are an effective communication to a culture that thinks with its eyes and lives in the spirit, in the emotional and physical moment. And so what we are going to try to do in this class is there's seeds of God's words and hints of the gospel that can be found in any low or high form of art. And creative impulses are in every human being that will lead them to maybe to a new sense of wonder, an understanding that they're born in the image of God, and to see God's wider revelation in the world that they live in that may bring them to Jesus Christ. And so this Sunday school will be fun, and it'll be different. It'll be like Paul's Mars Hill speech in the 21st century. The class discussions will be incorporating works of art, music, movies, TV, poetry, literature. For example, I used in talking with the high school kids about why does God allow evil, pain, and suffering just before the pandemic closed this last year. I used a scene from Lucy discovering the magic wardrobe in the movie The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And in talking about the Apostles' Creed, we looked at the creation scene in Terrence Malick's the tree of Life that starred Brad Pitt. And so every week we'll interweave these works of literature along with a biblical worldview and God's script in the scriptures, and have an in-depth study and also about the defense of the Christian faith. And so every couple of weeks we'll discuss a new topic, a new scripture. The class content will maybe include every 6 weeks assigning a movie that will be watched, and then we will discuss it, all with the intent to talk about it from a biblical worldview and God's inherent word. And so the class will also include lessons from an English Bible study, a year-long study that was done in 1920, right after World War I was done, and right after the Spanish pandemic flu faded away, where 50 million people combined died. And it's interesting that 1920 year-long studies incorporated the arts and the gospel to help that those people heal their faith and their lives. And so all the Sunday school lessons will help us experience the wider presence of God and reveal the good news of Jesus Christ and his salvation. And so I want to close with this one final true story on this class announcement. There is a Catholic priest, true story, Catholic priest wandering under a beautiful, taking a walk under a beautiful, starry, crystal clear night. And he came across a couple passionately kissing and very much in love. And so he stopped and looked at them. And the couple, noticing the stranger looking at them, stopped kissing and awkwardly glanced at him. And the priest smiled and said, "Hello," and he said, "Tell me one thing," he asked the couple. "What you're doing right now, how's that related to the stars?" And then he left. And the couple was confused and speechless. This Sunday school class will not only try to understand his question, but also endeavor to answer that question, as well as other questions about life, the meaning of life, and our life experiences, all from a Christian perspective. Thank you, and God bless you.
So, June 6th, first Sunday in June, if you're interested, there's some info, and there'll be more info in the coming weeks and emails, etc. As we look and think about all of life and how Christ is connected to all of life, Psalm 40 is our call to worship today. And I'm just going to read the first five verses. These are pretty familiar verses for good reason. "I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after a lie. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts toward us. None can compare with you. I will proclaim and tell of them, yet they are more than can be told." We get to sing songs to the Lord and to each other today. And as that happens, you're going to discover, even through the songs that are selected, it's going to lead us through the process of remembering so many deep, rich truths about God and about the gospel. So I invite you to stand, and we'll sing "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
Thank you. singing on that first song. Amen. We said on that first, sang on that first verse, "Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise." God's never ceasing streams of mercy call for our songs of loudest praise. We praise him together. Psalm 113 says, "Praise, O servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth?"
Who is like the Lord our God, strong.
God, we rejoice, we boast together that you are our salvation in Jesus. Our debt is paid. God, we raise our voices in praise to you. Help us to continue to lift our hearts in praise to you. Amen. God, we pray that together. We state that before you, that all we have before you is Christ. We have no righteousness of our own. We have no perfection or performance to boast in. We have only Jesus to boast in. We have only Jesus to claim and say, He's all we have. He is our life before you. God, convince us of that once again as we open your word now. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You all have to bear with me. I'm still new around here, and I just realized I didn't dismiss the kids after the second song.
You're good. They were supposed to hear that one, too. You're good. You're good.
Thank you guys for bearing with me on that. If there's any kids still around.
Yeah, so if there's anybody birth through fifth grade, now would be the time. I think they kind of saw the screen there toward the end and slipped out. But as we rejoice in the fact that all we have is Christ, Christ is sufficient. He is all we need. And I invite you just to go ahead and sit. I'm going to pray for our kids and our children's church teachers as you guys sit, and then we'll open the word together. Father, thank you so much for blessing us with children. The gift it is, God, to be a parent, but also, Lord, the gift it is just to be a part of a church family that has so many children. Lord, we pray that you would give them eyes to see you today, ears to hear you, and hearts to respond to your love. Lord, I pray that you would speak to and through every children's ministry teacher as they proclaim the gospel of your son Jesus and point them to Jesus as the author and finisher, the author and perfecter of our faith. May you also work that great work in us today as well. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we will be in Acts chapter 7 today. We were in Acts chapter 7, you may remember, last week. And because I knew I had 2 weeks to get through this, I didn't go all that quickly, which means today we have a fairly big chunk to cover unless, I guess you all pray for me, that I would be sensitive to where the Lord wants us to go today. Someone shared with me last week that I'm not sure how much it is what Stephen said to the Sanhedrin as opposed to why Stephen said what he said. Stephen is going to take the Sanhedrin through the full scope of redemptive history that's recorded in the Old Testament. He talks about Abraham and Moses and David and Solomon and the prophets. But this is stuff the Sanhedrin would have known. At least, they would have known it up here. And if you have been churched for any number of years, there's a lot of things that you know up here. The miracle of the Holy Spirit is to get what you know up here, down here. And guess what? There is one hope that we have in that miracle. Hebrews 7:25 tells us that Jesus is able to save us completely and fully because he lives to intercede. He lives to pray for you and me. So, back in the day, maybe 20-some years ago, there was this bracelet and this fad that came out called WWJD, question mark, stood for, what would Jesus do? It's interesting because all throughout the Gospels, Jesus is constantly doing things that are unpredictable. He doesn't follow the normal script. It's sometimes hard to answer that question. But it's not hard to answer that question, what is Jesus doing now? Now, in this moment, Jesus is sitting beside his father and saying to his father, hey, You know, my younger brothers and sisters at the bridge, 504 East 12th today, help them get it. Bring your Holy Spirit with such a fullness that they walk out that door, seeing me, hearing me, loving me, and following more than they did when they first walked in. You know what the amazing thing is about Jesus' prayers? They are effectual. They are effective. They get the job done. Now, can we resist? Yes, absolutely. We can resist for a little while. But God is gracious to help get us where we need to be. He promises that he who began a good work in us will complete it. He will finish it. He's not done with us. The crazy thing is, Stephen presenting the good news through the Old Testament lens of redemptive history is proving that God is not done with the Sanhedrin, even though they're described as a stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts at the end of this sermon. So let me just tell you at the front end of the sermon, before this day is over, before this worship service is over, before this sermon is over, you are going to hear me say to you that sometimes you are a stiff-necked person with an uncircumcised heart. And sometimes I am a stiff-necked person with an uncircumcised heart. It's much easier in our day-to-day interaction with others to look at someone else and say, you are a stiff-necked person with an uncircumcised heart. If you could just get it together, if you could just wake up and smell the coffee and behave, then everything would be so much easier. What's interesting, though, is the gospel, first, by the power of the Holy Spirit, needs to do work with me, myself, and I. That first, I need to see my need for God's grace. And first and foremost, you need to see your need for God's grace. Becky Grapple, who Becky and Joe led us in song today, thank you for that. She also wrote the email reflection this week. If you've not gotten a chance to read it, which, by the way, all of these are excellent. Our team is fantastic. It's kind of like a secret we don't want to keep a secret, that like these are really good reflections and devotionals to read that prepare our hearts for the text. But what I want to emphasize this morning about it is the whole thing is good, but the title just sticks. It's Remembering to Remember. It's an invitation for us each moment of every day to remember, oh yeah, God did this, and God did that, and God's not done with us. So Stephen addresses the Sanhedrin as brothers and fathers. It's very clear that he has affection in his heart for them, even though they're doing the wrong thing, and quite honestly, they're mistreating him unjustly. They have grabbed him by force and taken him to a place where he did not want to go, and he is still wanting to help them remember to remember. And Stephen starts it with, the God of glory appeared. It's our hope and prayer that the God of glory will appear to us today as well. Last week, we touched on Abraham and we touched on Joseph. For the sake of time, for the reading today, we will start with chapter 7, verse 17, and we will look at Moses and, God willing, David as well before we're done. Acts 7, beginning with verse 17, says this. But as the time of the promise drew near, which God had granted to Abraham, the people increased and multiplied in Egypt, until there arose over Egypt another king who did not know Joseph. He dealt shrewdly with our race and forced our fathers to expose their infants so that they would not be kept alive. At this time, Moses was born, and he was beautiful in God's sight. And he was brought up for 3 months in his father's house. And when he was exposed, Pharaoh's daughter adopted him and brought him up as her own son. And Moses was instructed in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and he was mighty in his words and deeds. When he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brothers, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them being wronged, he defended the oppressed man and avenged him by striking down the Egyptian. He supposed that his brothers would understand that God was giving them salvation by his hand, but they did not understand. And on the following day, he appeared to them as they were quarreling and tried to reconcile them, saying, "Men, you are brothers. Why do you wrong each other?" But the man who was wronging his neighbor thrust him aside, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you killed the Egyptian yesterday?" At this retort, Moses fled and became an exile in the land of Midian, where he became the father of two sons. Now, when 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, in a flame of fire in a bush. When Moses saw it, he was amazed at the sight, and as he drew near to look, there came the voice of the Lord, "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob." And Moses trembled and did not dare to look. Then the Lord said to him, "Take off the sandals from your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their groaning, and I have come down to deliver them. And now, come, I will send you to Egypt." This Moses, whom they rejected, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge?" This man God sent as both ruler and redeemer by the hand of the angel who appeared to him in the bush. This man led them out, performing wonders and signs in Egypt and at the Red Sea and in the wilderness for 40 years. This is the Moses who said to the Israelites, "God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers." This is the one who was in the congregation in the wilderness with the angel who spoke to him at Mount Sinai and with our fathers. He received living oracles to give to us. Our fathers refused to obey him, but thrust him aside, and in their hearts they turned to Egypt, saying to Aaron, "Make for us gods who will go before us. As for this Moses who led us out from the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And they made a calf in those days and offered a sacrifice to the idol and were rejoicing in the works of their hands. But God turned away and gave them over to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets, "Did you bring to me slain beasts and sacrifices during the 40 years in the wilderness, O house of Israel? You took up the tent of Moloch and the star of your god Rephan, the images that you made to worship, and I will send you into exile beyond Babylon." Our fathers had the tent of witness in the wilderness, just as he who spoke to Moses directed him to make it according to the pattern that he had seen. Our fathers, in turn, brought it in with Joshua when they dispossessed the nations that God drove out before our fathers. So it was until the days of David, who found favor in the sight of God and asked to find a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built a house for him. Yet the Most High does not dwell in houses made by hands. As the prophet says, "Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Did not my hand make all these things? You stiff-necked people, uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who announced beforehand the coming of the righteous one, whom you have now betrayed and murdered. You who received the law as delivered by angels and did not keep it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word and your spirit, and we need your help. Help us to see what you want us to see this morning. Thank you, Jesus, for living to intercede and pray for us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I have people in premarital counseling do this activity, and they're supposed to timeline their life. You ever tried doing that before? Just start, I was born, dot. Present day, dot. And then I ask them, if you can choose 5 to 10 dots for premarital counseling, it's before you met your significant other, what would those dots be? And then 5 dots after you met your significant other. And what I tell them is, you know, graduating from high school, don't have that be one of your dots. Not that it's not important, but if it is that important, you better explain that. I'm not looking for rites of passage that by God's grace most of us go through. I'm looking for dots that say, in this moment, at this time, God did something in my heart. It changed me. Or, in this moment, at this time, when this coach or teacher said this hurtful thing, when this loved one passed away, it left a wound that won't go away. What's been amazing is the couples that actually take that activity seriously is that sometimes the significant other says, what? Like, I knew that that happened, but I had no idea how that impacted you. And some, I didn't even know that about you. Maybe we need to talk about this a little bit more. Good question. Today, just in this moment, timeline your life. Over the course of this past week, just these past 7 days, what dots would be there? What conversations have you had with others? What expectations have you had that either exceeded your expectation or completely flopped? What wounds have you experienced this past week? What joys are you celebrating today? And can I say more than anything else today? And we're going to get to the text, because faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. But faith also comes by the way that the Holy Spirit speaks to us in every given moment. So to be aware of those dots that you've experienced this past week. And for some of you in your prayer life and in your devotional life, you've already invited the Holy Spirit to speak into those dots. But for some of you, you haven't given yourself margin of time to do that. It's valuable to ask the Holy Spirit, who already knows your heart, knows your dots, and knows what you experienced this past week. Would you speak into that part of my life? Would you administer your healing? Or would you provide conviction? Would you give wisdom and discernment in this moment, in this place and space now? I wonder how Stephen's sermon would have been responded to differently if the Sanhedrin would have done that, his listeners. What if before Stephen spoke, the Sanhedrin would have done a timeline of the past week? They have expectations that don't get met. They have wounds and hurts. They have fears. They have joys. And right before Stephen's speaking, the Sanhedrin go, God of Jacob, God who promises a redeemer, I want you to speak in to these areas of my life this past week. I want to know how you make sense of what I'm going through, which so often doesn't feel like it makes any sense at all. I don't know if it would have changed, but I have a feeling it might have. You see, they're being accused of being a stiff-necked people with uncircumcised hearts that continually reject the Holy Spirit, then what they're going to do is go, no, I don't give you permission, God, to speak into this area of my life. I'm going to reject you. You know, it's crazy. A lot of times we go, oh yeah, well that's the world out there, but not the church in here. Oh, baloney. That is often more the church in here. You see, the world out there actually does want to make sense of their dots. Sometimes they do better with pain and havoc and a wreck than those who are churched do. Why is that? Because sometimes the church brings expectations to the table. Doesn't matter what your dots were. Just smile when people say, how are you? And do well. When sometimes, it's not even what the Holy Spirit wants. Remember what I said last week? There's one kind of person in the world. A broken person. There are people who are willing to acknowledge their brokenness and people that are not. So how are you broken this week? Can I talk to you guys about a guy named Moses? You see, Moses actually writes in the Pentateuch that he was a good-looking baby. He actually gets to write that himself, okay? He wrote Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And he said, I was a good-looking baby. I don't know if, like, most parents believe that their kids are good-looking, most grandparents, and like he just heard that so much that he just writes and says, I was a good-looking baby. And 3 months he gets to spend with his mom and dad before Pharaoh, the leader of Egypt, that's intimidated by these Israelites that just keep multiplying in number. But why do they keep multiplying in number? Because God said they would. That even though Abram and Sarah struggle to have a baby and it doesn't happen until Abram's 100 years old, God said, your descendants will outnumber the stars and the sky. And the Egyptians are now worried about this Israelite threat, so they come up with a way to try to squash the hand of God. You ever tried to do that before? God wants to get your attention about something and you just try to squash it. Shut it down. You can try. But it's kind of but this is just the visual word picture I have. A kid that's upset with a parent, okay? And the parent just has his hand out and holding back the forehead, and the kid is just trying to, like, hit the... It isn't gonna work. And sadly, the king of Egypt doesn't get it. And God, in his sense of humor and irony, goes, okay, you're trying to knock out my people here that are supposed to show you that you can be my people too? Guess what I'm going to do? I am actually going to have your daughter, king of Egypt, adopt the person I will use to deliver my people. I don't know if the daughter of the king of Egypt had faith in the one true God or not. It's another one of those questions I plan on asking when I get to heaven. But I will say this. Don't ever underestimate how your children will make your heart tender to God. It seems as though for the king of Egypt that doesn't happen. He continues to harden his heart. He continues to reject. But, you know, we're pumped about reopening Children's Church. But can I say that the kids of our church often have more faith than the adults? Give you a quick example. Youth ministry, middle school, we're talking about David. And this past Sunday, I talk about three postures of prayer that were biblical. The whole bow your head, close your eyes, fold your hands. Nothing necessarily wrong with that, but you can't find that way of praying in the Bible. In the Bible, it is standing with arms out to heaven, okay? Now, sometimes, guys, when we're singing a song or something, this posture makes a handful of us, maybe many of us, somewhat uncomfortable, okay? Can I say, actually, that this posture, while singing praises to God and praying, is actually going back to the roots and foundation of our faith? It is actually more contemporary of a practice for you to sing like this. Now, does God hear you better when you're like this? I don't know. Depends on what's going on in your heart. Some people that are like this, their hearts are so far from God that, like, it doesn't matter. And some people that are like this, their hearts are outstretched arms. So we need to be careful to know, guys, so much of life is more than meets the eye. We need to be so careful about quick to judge the external appearance of people and things and opinions. You don't know the heart. Only God does. So cut it out. Lest you think you can do better than God. And I don't think that's going to happen. So, back to the story. Second posture of prayer is kneeling. And the third posture of prayer is laying face down. And we have this great Bible lesson on Daniel and praying in the lion's den. And at the end, I say, okay, guys, let's pray. I go back to my mode. Well, you know what? The middle schoolers listened a heck of a lot better than the teacher. And I say amen. And Joy Runyon is laying down on the ground. And I go, huh. She actually applied the Bible immediately. I think a way to guard against your hearts being far from God. You may acknowledge him with your lips, but your hearts are far from him, is a refusal to immediately respond to the prompting of the Holy Spirit and act right then and there. Just act. And here's what's crazy. Listen to a podcast this week. Nikki Gumbel, who is the leader of Alpha, which we are having an Alpha course after Labor Day again. More on that in the future. But Nikki Gumbel was interviewing a guy named Sandy, whose last name I think is Miller, I forgot. But what's interesting is they talked about how the Holy Spirit was at work in the life of their church. And one thing that they joked about is they said, you know, as leaders and ministers and just as people, we tend to be control freaks. We tend to like what's predictable. And what we discovered was if the Holy Spirit was really going to minister in our midst, we had to acknowledge that we actually had no idea what this was going to look like. We had to let go and let God. And he said, and sometimes we looked absolutely silly. And sometimes God gave someone a word, or there was an experience, or there was a moment that led to one of those dots on the timeline. It's like, this moment right here, I am forever changed. And this will forever be on my timeline now, moving forward. And ultimately what they talked about is, you know, you just have to kind of decide. Are you going to say, God, I want you to work like that? Or are you going to try to put God in a box? The Sanhedrin had a very predictable Jewish system at work where there were rules and regulations and rituals, and they just tried to put God in that box. And when Stephen says, guess what? God was never in the box. Even the box you think you put him in, you think that like it's just the temple, he's not just in that zip code, guys. He's all over the place all the time. So Moses grows up. He's raised by Egyptians. He has Egyptian culture and language. And then at 40 years old, Moses decides, I am the deliverer. Now, Stephen is very kind to Moses in this part of the narrative. When you go back to Exodus, it does seem as though Moses decided to rush the hand of God. That Moses actually looked at his resume and his credentials and said, wow, I can do it. I share it with you guys just when I am most nervous about preaching. When I think I can do it. I can't do this. But we saw Joe and Becky do in leading us in worship through song. They can't do it. What our children's ministry teachers there are doing, they can't do it. The Holy Spirit can do it through you. But you can't do it apart from the Holy Spirit. Serving tables, Acts 6, the beginning, remember what they were looking for? Men who are full of spirit and the faith and wisdom. To do what? To hand widows food. They're saying, if you don't have these credentials, if you are not full of the spirit and faith, like, yeah, I get it. You can sing some songs. I can say some words. You can hand some food to somebody. But is it going to make an eternal impact on the life of that other person? Not unless the Holy Spirit comes. Come, Lord Jesus, come. So Moses jumps in. It's a train wreck. The crazy thing is the guy he's even trying to defend the next day actually turns on him. It couldn't get any worse. There's a warrant out for his arrest, and Moses just like flees. Used to be the Southwest Airlines commercial years ago. Somebody did something absolutely stupid, and then the caption was, want to get away? Southwest Airlines, $44 one way. I don't think it's that cheap anymore. But Moses probably at that point didn't care how expensive it was. He just wanted to get away. If you have felt the train wreck of life, and often life will throw you train wrecks, guess what? You just want to run for the hills. You just want to hide. The guilt and shame of that experience is just, I want no part of anything anymore. But you know what's amazing? God gives Moses some good graces in the midst of his exile. He gets married and he has two sons. But for the next 40 years, he's out in the middle of nowhere. And he probably feels like God himself has shelved him. Some of you maybe feel that way. Some of you feel like, you know what? Based on what I did, based on who I was, God will never use me. Moses was a murderer. And one day, 40 years later, which the number 40 in the Bible means this number of fullness, the right amount of time. At just the right time, the angel of the Lord appears to Moses in a burning bush. He says, I am the God of your father Abraham and your father Isaac and your father Jacob. And I have seen and heard, and I have come to act. Sometimes we feel like nobody sees us. Nobody hears us. I understand the practical, we don't want to spread COVID to one another situation with these things. But you know what? When I already feel shame, when I already feel like I shouldn't be seen, we can hide. And we can feel for a moment that nobody, nobody, including God, has any use for us anymore, wants to be with us. And I know that this was so entrenched in Moses' thinking because of what he said after God told him, I am sending you to go and free the people. Remember what Moses said? I can't do it. And then he had reason after reason after reason. I don't know who you are, God. I don't know your name. They won't believe me. Who am I? I'm not special. I don't have a sign. I don't have a magic trick. I don't have anything I can do. You know what God says? I will be with you. I will see you. I will hear you, and I will act on your behalf. And he did. From the plagues to the parting of the Red Sea, God acted on Moses' behalf. But you know what the people did? The people refused to see it. The people refused to acknowledge that God was acting on their behalf. And they make another god. And we have the golden calf that is worshipped. And after the golden calf is worshipped, then we fast forward to Joshua and David and Solomon. And there is this temple that's built. And it's majestic. And God says, I will reside here. What they failed to see is not just reside here, I will reside everywhere. God has always been everywhere all the time. And he asks in verse 49, it's a quote of Isaiah 66, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What kind of house will you build for me, says the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Did not my hand make all these things? Well, did not my hand make all these things? All this is all God's. Isaiah 66 goes on. Some of you will be faster than me. Isaiah 66, 2b says this. This is God talking. This is the one I esteem. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. So God says, You can't make a place that can put me in a box, but I can tell you where I love to reside and abide. I love to be in the place of the one who is humble and contrite in spirit and who trembles at my word. Stephen then calls them stiff-necked, uncircumcised in heart and ears, and he tells them, you always resist the Holy Spirit. By God's grace, I have a wife and a handful of friends, and I have parents that over the years have not used words like stiff-necked and uncircumcised heart and eyes or ears, but they have lovingly, because they love me, called me to task on things. They have handed me a metaphorical mirror and said, you want to look in there? Do you want to see where you're at right now? Stephen is handing them mirrors, brothers and fathers. You have always rejected the Holy Spirit, but you don't have to continue rejecting the Holy Spirit. Here's grace upon grace upon grace. Take the mirror, look at your face, and be changed by the only righteous one. That's how Stephen describes Jesus in this text. It's funny that Jesus is not mentioned in his sermon, but the title Jesus, the righteous one, whom you have betrayed and murdered. The righteous one who fulfilled the law that the Sanhedrin accuses Stephen to blaspheming against. Well, that same righteous one is here by way of the Holy Spirit today. And he is inviting you and I. Well, he's handing us metaphorical mirrors. Some of you spend a lot of time in the mirror, and these things have like the selfie option, and then I don't know how to do it, but you can actually like make yourself even better than you really are with all these apps. And I've never tried that. But I did, as I thought through, like, how does this come to a close? I thought, oh my goodness, that's what we do spiritually. But here's the crazy thing. You don't have to do that. Because Jesus sees through it all. And it has not changed his opinion or his feelings or his love for you. In fact, when you do all the filters to make yourself look better than you really are, I think Jesus says, okay, let me know when you're done with all of that and when you really want to come to me, and then I would love to meet with you. Some of you are going to be afraid to look at yourself in the mirror. You shouldn't be. There is a scary first step where God shows you your sin. He shows you that, yes, you have had an uncircumcised heart and ears, and you are stiff-necked and stubborn. But then, it's like the mirror that, you know, actually shows you you, but then shows you him. With a capital H. that after you see that, then you see Jesus. And you see Jesus as one that suffered and died to make you righteous and clean and pure and accepted and seen and heard and loved as the beloved sons and daughters of the King. So we have communion. We have a meal that on the night that Jesus was betrayed by his friends, betrayed by Judas and abandoned by his friends, because they were stiff-necked with uncircumcised hearts and ears. Jesus, amazingly enough, did not look at what they were doing and say, never mind, because they're stiff-necked with uncircumcised hearts and ears, I'm not dying for them anymore. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And while you are still stiff-necked with uncircumcised ears and heart, Christ loves you and sees you and is the only one who can heal you and make you righteous. So I'm going to ask Joe and Becky to come. And we're going to provide a little bit of time before we actually partake in communion for you to go back to what I encouraged you to do at the beginning and to look at the timeline of the last week. And I want you to center in specifically on expectations that didn't turn out the way you hoped, of things that people said to you or you said to yourself that created wounds. And what's amazing is Jesus is inviting you to a table to eat with him and he with you. But what he wants to do is he wants to speak to those unmet expectations and those wounds and those hardships. He wants to speak about the ways that you have been sinned against and the ways that you have sinned against others. And he won't be quiet unless you continue to be stiff-necked. If you continue to look at that mirror and go, I'm okay, I'm okay, he'll say, okay, I know you're not okay, but I'll let you sit with thinking you're okay until you want to get real and honest. But if you're courageous by the Spirit enough to get real and honest in front of him, he has things to say to you. Things that are much more valuable than anything I could say to you or anyone else could say to you. And Jesus says, my sheep know my voice. He also says that all who the Father gives to me will come to me, and no one can snatch them out of my hand. So may the voice of Jesus speak into those areas of your life this past week. Let's provide some time for him to do that now. Thank you. there's at least one person here this morning that has experienced rejection. And you need to hear this. God says in Isaiah 41, I took you from the ends of the earth, from its farthest corners, I called you. I said, you are my servant. I have chosen you and have not rejected you. So do not fear. I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. As we prepare for communion, this table is a table that is open. It's a table that is inclusive to all who have received by faith Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. So on the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread. I invite you to take the wafer. And he broke the bread. And he said, this is my body broken. Let's stop there for a second. Remember what I said? There is one kind of person in the world, a broken person. You know, there's only one person who wasn't broken, Jesus. And you know what he did with the bread? He said, this is my body broken for you. You were broken before I came to rescue you, and now I will break my body. I will allow my body to be broken so yours will be healed. Jesus' body broken for us. Do this in remembrance of him. I have a feeling that when Jesus broke bread with his disciples, there weren't any of these little lid things. It might have been an easier meal. But you know what's amazing? Whether there's lids or not, it doesn't in any way, shape, or form change the truth of Jesus' body being broken for us and his blood being shed for us. So on the same night, he took the cup and he said, this is my blood. This represents my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. So as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim my death until I come again, because I didn't stay dead. I'm praying for you now, and I'm coming back for my people. You see, the same Jesus who heard his people in slavery in Egypt, he saw and heard and he came. He sees us today in Alton, Illinois, and he will see and hear and come to our rescue too. So let's drink to him. The Lord does not want you and I to be people of fear, but people of faith. He does not want us to experience the lie of rejection, but the truth of acceptance because of Jesus. And what I've discovered is just like I sometimes need my wife and my kids and my family and my friends to hand me that mirror when I'm stiff-necked and I have an uncircumcised heart. I also need my wife and my kids and my family and my church family to hand me that mirror to say, but who are you in Christ? You are loved, you are forgiven, you are redeemed, you are healed. You are now, therefore, more than a conqueror through him who loved you. Our response to this great news, this good news of great joy, is to just simply say, Jesus, thank you. We're going to have an opportunity to sing this song called Jesus, Thank You. But I want to invite you to ask the Lord, if you're prompting me to do something right now, Jesus, to come forward and pray, to hug a friend, a brother, a sister, to speak a word to someone, the Holy Spirit wants to do something today in the hearts of many that put a dot on the timeline and say, May 2nd, 2021, somebody spoke to me, but it wasn't them, it was God. And it flipped a switch that I needed to have flipped. Some of you are supposed to receive those words. Some of you are supposed to give those words. And some of you are just supposed to sit and say, Jesus, thank you. The Holy Spirit will let you know what you're supposed to do. But we do not want to quench or grieve what he wants to do in our midst as we sing this song. May the Lord Jesus have his way now. I invite you.
Satisfied, Jesus, thank you. Once you're in on me, now seated.
most powerful gift in the world is the love of God. His love is perfect. His love drives out fear. But the enemy will speak to you and I moment by moment, day by day, and tell us, you're not worthy, you don't deserve it, you're not good enough. Jesus says, I love you. I have made you worthy, and nothing will separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. He sealed the gift of love with his blood, and he showed it will never end by rising from the dead. Receive his love today. Just receive it. Had a friend in seminary, had a daughter, has a daughter. I don't know how old she is now, but when she was 8 years old, she was afraid of God. This person who's looking for you to mess up and do things wrong and tell you, you're not worthy. I don't love you. And he broke down in a Greek study group with me and two other guys and said, I want my daughter to know the God that is love. Please pray with me that she may know that. Within a week, he came back to Greek study group and said, you aren't going to believe what happened. My daughter had a dream. And she woke up laughing. And we said, what are you dreaming about? And she said, I had a dream that I was in this field with Jesus. And we were dancing to the song, Who Let the Dogs Out? He jokingly said, I didn't know Jesus knows that song, but I guess he knows everything. But it flipped for her. May it flip for us. May we believe the truth of Zephaniah 3:17, that the Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. Sit with that today. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Let's receive his love as we receive this benediction. And now, God, to you who did a work, may we put a dot in this moment as we receive the fact that you delight in your people. You quiet us with your love. You rejoice over us with singing. And you cure us and heal us from our stiff-necked attitudes. And lead us into your love this week. Because of your name and for your glory, we pray, Jesus. We say thank you and we love you. Because you first loved us. Amen. May you go with God's grace and peace.